Hi everyone, welcome to CMC Conversations. I'm Parishi Kanuga, a class of 26 here at CMC, and today I'm interviewing Professor Ran Libeskind-Hadas, who is the founder of the Kravis Department of Integrated Sciences. Hi Professor, welcome on.
Hi Parishi, thanks for having me. It's a pleasure to be here.
Awesome, so feel free to introduce yourself.
All right, so my name is Ran Libeskind-Hadas, as Parishi mentioned. My students just call me Prof. Ran because the last name is so long and complicated I can barely remember it myself. I am a faculty member at CMC. I just joined about 2 years ago as founding chair of the Kravis Department of Integrated Sciences. Before that, I spent 28 years at Harvey Mudd College in the Department of Computer Science, and my area of expertise is in algorithms, but in particular as they apply to problems in biology, a field called computational biology. And part of what brought me to CMC was this incredibly exciting opportunity to build a new natural sciences department that integrates the natural sciences themselves, computation and data science as vehicles for discovery, and also integrates with the fabric of CMC, in particular looking at aspects of social impact, ethics, government policy as they're connected to the sciences.
So what is integrated sciences in relation to the general fields of, that we understand, physics, biology, chemistry?
Yeah, it's a great question, Parishi. So integrated sciences really means teaching those subjects, but breaking down some of the traditional boundaries that have defined them for so long. And those boundaries have actually served us well for centuries, but increasingly, some of the most important problems that scientists are exploring and that have an impact on society really cross those boundaries. So problems, for example, that we think of as related to health bring in concepts from chemistry and computation and biology and sometimes neuroscience and sometimes environmental science. And so it's really important to educate the next generation of scientists to be fearless problem solvers who are not intimidated by the increasingly artificial boundaries between those disciplines.
So then how do the classes and curriculum of the department forego those boundaries?
So the way that the curricula is going to be designed to break down those boundaries is to frame the sciences around these cross-cutting socio-scientific problems and challenges. And those are, for us, health, the brain, and the planet. And so the idea here is to teach virtually every course framed around a number of compelling current problems. For example, what is the prevalence of antibiotic resistance in our water supply? What kinds of promises and challenges does genetic engineering hold for the future? And then to teach the fundamental science in response to getting students to be in a place where they can answer those questions themselves. And that means giving them both the natural science background, the biology, the physics, the chemistry, the neuroscience, the computational and mathematical skills that they need to explore those problems in conjunction with laboratory techniques, and then ultimately to let them make their own discoveries and express them, write them for a broad audience, engage with people outside the sciences to really have deep conversations about issues of ethics and policy and so forth. So the idea here is really to teach the natural sciences, for sure, but framed around these guiding questions so that students are motivated to learn the science because they can see that they're using it right away to explore something interesting rather than being told, wait a couple of years and you'll see why we have you teach, how you learn this material.
Exactly. It's like, rather than just going from a textbook and learning these concepts and how people have vaguely applied them in the past, it's like you're applying it on a real world level and you're really interacting with these problems using these new skill sets that you're acquiring as you go.
That's exactly our goal, yeah. And that's not in any way to disparage the way that science has been taught in the past. There's lots of value in that too, but we feel that in particular for CMC, there is a strong argument to be made for building a science program that integrates into the very culture and the values and the aspirations of our students.
So, I mean, one thing that the program incorporates is coding, knowledge of data skills, and having that is kind of just a foundation to what you do moving forward. So I'm wondering, just in a general scheme of things, how is like computational knowledge becoming more and more relevant in science?
Great question. So I strongly believe that computational sophistication, computational reasoning is becoming a fundamental literacy just like writing is. No one would disagree that writing is absolutely something that we have to build up over the course of our lives and certainly while we're in college. And the same is true of computation. Just having a basic literacy of understanding how the computational world works, because so much of it, everything we do every day is highly computational. And so I think it's important for a few reasons. One is it's important that students be able to write their own code when they need to, but not everyone needs to be a software engineer. That's not our goal. It's just important to have that toolkit available to you as a mechanism for discovery, as a toolkit for that development of insight. But I think it's also important just as a way of understanding the world around us. When someone makes claims, for example, that ChatGPT is going to be able to do this, it's really helpful if you have some understanding of how ChatGPT actually works. And so you can think about that critically. Like, well, actually, based on the technologies that ChatGPT and its ilk are using, like, that's not going to happen. There may be other things that will happen. Maybe new technologies will come from elsewhere. It's important to be it's important to have the toolkit to be able to evaluate these kinds of claims critically. And in this society, it's just absolutely part of basic literacy.
I think that's really interesting that possibly in the future, students in elementary school could start learning coding, and that's just going to be a skill in their back pocket, as you said, just like writing. And you mentioned ChatGPT, and my mind just automatically went to artificial intelligence in general. How do you think that the Kravis Department of Integrated Sciences, the curriculum, could possibly facilitate knowledge of machine learning in the future?
Yeah, so machine learning is a powerful set of ideas, and we will definitely be teaching that in our curriculum. Actually, we're already teaching some of those ideas in the Codes of Life course, which is our GE course, some elementary ideas there.
Really? How so?
Well, in our course, our students wrote ChatCMC, a small version of ChatGPT that basically looks at a corpus of writing. We gave it Shakespeare sonnets, and we also gave it some Dr. Seuss books. And based on training that, as opposed to the entire web, which is what ChatGPT endeavors to do, it was able to generate text that was seemingly similar and looked reasonably sensible to the outside observer.
So you taught students how to make their own mini models.
Exactly. What we call, rather than a large language model, which is what ChatGPT is, we call it a small language model. But basically the same concept, the basic idea is there. And granted, it was a one-week assignment in introductory course, so it was the first exposure to that. But our idea is to spiral upwards throughout our curriculum. So by the time a student graduates, if they've gone through our science major in particular, they will have a fairly robust toolkit in AI and machine learning, among other computational ideas, that allow them both to build artifacts when they need to for their own usage, but also to contribute to the development of others. And thirdly, to reason about the future and make informed decisions about those technologies.
So what do you mean by reasoning about the future, having that general knowledge?
Yeah, so one way that one can reason about the future with that general knowledge is when someone reads a claim in the popular media that this tool has the power to do the following, one can look at that and say, well, I actually know how that technology works fundamentally, and that claim is just not supported. Or that claim is being somewhat mischaracterized. And I think that's really important. So if, for example, you read an article about the future of medical diagnostics through AI, I think our students will have enough fundamental background to understand how such technologies would work, what their promise is, and also what their limitations are, and be able to express to folks who have perhaps less background in that field what the real issues are here, what the challenges are, what the opportunities are, and that's something that I think our students will be exceptionally well prepared to do.
I think one part of science is just a general understanding of the content and the way things work, but the other part of science is being able to explain that to other people. And I think at CMC, the way that we're taught to communicate and this program that's being built out, I think we might have a lot more scientific communicators coming about.
That's our hope. Our hope is that our students, whether they decide to major in the sciences or not, feel much more comfortable writing about science, speaking about science, and also to be very mindful of to whom they're communicating. So it's one thing if you're communicating to a group of high school students, another if you're writing a science piece in a newspaper, and yet another if you're writing to scientists or policymakers. Helping our students to understand what is the right level to pitch these ideas based on to whom that they are trying to communicate is also a really key skill.
And how are you going to do that?
Well, for example, in the Codes of Life, our students started with their first writing assignment was to write a half-page essay for a hypothetical high school biology book about social Darwinism, basically the misuse of Darwin's theory of evolution towards perfecting the human race. And unfortunately, some of those ideas still remain present and lingering in our society. And so being able to explain to an audience, in this case, a high school audience, like how it really misuses science is an incredibly important thing. So our students started with that. The next thing they did was they wrote an essay for something like the New York Times science section on the future of genetic engineering, how it works, and what's the opportunities and challenges here. And so we're kind of moving from different stages of writing for different audiences, eventually to writing for scientists.
And in a typical science class, you don't just jump from social Darwinism to genetic engineering, nor do I even wonder if you talk about social Darwinism in a science class. So that's really interesting that you were able to prompt students to just deconstruct that whole pseudoscience and just teach them those communication skills that go hand in hand with an understanding of the material. So that's really cool.
Thank you.
So just along with this science program, you guys are also establishing a science building. Do you want to talk more about that?
Sure. The Robert Day Science Center is under construction. And that building is going to be absolutely beautiful. It is designed by the Danish architecture firm Bjarke Ingels Group, known as BIG. So it's a big building. it is a building that is going to be on the first floor, really a home for many different things college-wide and really not specific to the sciences per se. So there's going to be some lovely study spaces there, that cultivates innovation, kind of a maker space-like space, but with its own CMC unique kind of imprimatur. It's going to have some beautiful study spaces, some classrooms, a cafe. And so that's really intended to invite the entire community in. The second and third floors are science teaching and research laboratories and faculty offices. And one of the signature components is that research and teaching are happening side by side, lots of glass. So students in a first year science GE course can see their seniors, their friends doing their senior thesis right across the way, in another lab right next door, and their faculty doing research as well. So we want science to be transparent. We want to be visible to all visitors, our own students, the whole community. Another part of it, which I think is really exciting, is that it has some really beautiful spaces where students can just find themselves comfortable places to work, really close to where the faculty do their work, faculty offices and labs. And the idea is to really kind of break down the barriers between students and faculty, make it a common space where there can be just a lot of intellectual churn. And we've really been thoughtful and deliberate about how to make the spaces inviting for that.
That's really beautiful. And one thing that really stood out to me is when you said you want science to be transparent, which I totally understand, because as someone who has not really immersed herself in science yet, I have seen science and I've been intimidated by it because I just don't understand it at that complex level. And demystifying it in a way and just saying that, hey, anybody can learn this, it doesn't really matter. There's no like specific skill set that's just only gonna be good at science. Everybody can kind of excel. I think that's really inspiring. So the fact that you're cultivating that in the building space is really cool. So one question I had to follow with that is, do you think that learning is really enhanced in the right environment?
Learning is definitely enhanced in the right environment. I think that a physical environment that is warm and welcoming and makes it clear that you belong here sends a really strong signal. If a building is sterile, if it feels like there aren't places for students to plop down and feel really comfortable, get some food, some coffee, hang out, I just think that it suggests that there is a sort of us and them, and we really don't want an us and them. It's us and us. I think that's really important. And to the point about science being welcoming, both the building and the curriculum are really saying to CMC student body, everyone here is capable of being a scientist together. You don't have to be a science major. You're going to take our GE course. We're going to make sure that this course is warm and welcoming and supportive of students regardless of their background. In fact, we're designing it so that previous high school science background does not really advantage you particularly in this course. It's really starting from material that people haven't seen before. That too sends a strong signal. It's like, if you can be a scientist even if you've really never done it before, or even if you have negative views of it coming in, well, we you don't, it's okay if we, you know, we don't turn you into a scientist. That's not our goal. But we do want you to come out with a feeling of like, I actually can do science. I like it. It's interesting. That is success for us.
Awesome. Well, this was really exciting to hear about, and it was great having you on CMC Conversations.
Thank you so much for having me.
Thank you.